Hi, boys and girls. My name is Mrs. Bremer, and I'm here to read chapter 23. The first thing Flora did when she scrambled off the boat and onto solid ground was to look for her friend. A few dogs had made it to safety. Oscar was one of them. "Have you seen Sophia?" she asked him through chattering teeth. Oscar was dripping wet and trembling so hard it looked as if he might shake himself off his feet. He lowered his head but did not answer. A chain, still attached to a broken piece of wood, hung from his neck. Another dog was more helpful. Flora found out that only he and four other dogs had been released from their chains in time to jump into the first lifeboat. Oscar had been rescued later from the freezing waters. None of the others had survived. Flora felt like weeping. Cats were not great swimmers. In her bones, she knew that her small friend had never had a chance once the water rushed in. Still, she looked around desperately. Large emergency boxes from both lifeboats were dragged ashore. Tools, dry blankets, and cans of food came out. And when the boxes were empty, the men used axes to chop them up and build a fire. The blankets were laid down around the fire, and a mangy mix of teeth-chattering men and dogs huddled as close to it as they could. Some of the men dashed back out in a lifeboat to see if they could find any more supply boxes or bits of wood in the water. When they had warmed up a bit, others began building walls of snow for a shelter. There was still very little said. Flora gave up her search and nosed under a corner of a blanket. She now realized how cold she had become. She was shaking harder than she thought possible. But the cold in her bones was nothing compared to the ice in her heart. Sophia could be sharp-tongued and selfish. But without a friend to keep Flora's hope alive all those weeks in the belly of the ship, she didn't know if she would have survived. Now Sophia was gone. Rolled up in several blankets, the captain lay on the snow beside the fire, eyes closed. He did not move. Across the fire from Flora, Alaric and Oscar sit, shaking together. The boy had taken Oscar's chain off and was wrapped in a blanket. Flora was startled to see Alaric's heart beating inside his blanket. She watched, amazed, as his chest rippled and bumped. Then it popped out. This was no heart. It was an orange cat with pointy ears, and it looked around with wide eyes. When it saw Flora, it pushed itself free and bounded over to her. "Sophia!" Flora squealed. Sophia purred and rubbed against Flora. By some miracle, they had both survived. Now that she had a friend and teammate beside her, Flora thought she could face whatever challenges lay ahead. When Flora blinked her eyes awake the next morning, the low sun buttered the bumpy snow a light yellow. Boxes that weren't there the night before had been stacked nearby. Sophia's fur tickled her nose from where she was tucked in under Flora's chin. For a moment, all the fear and sadness from the day before overwhelmed Flora. She felt her heart twist for the brave dogs that didn't make it. Still, here she was, alive, with Sophia at her side. In the night, someone had covered her with a second blanket. The dogs, on the other hand, had moved away from the blankets. They lay in a rough circle in the snow with their noses pointed to the center. Flora imagined they were probably remembering and mourning their lost companions. As the day continued, Flora watched the men finish the walls of the snow cabin and place one of the lifeboats on top as a roof. They did not sing as they worked. They did not shout or curse or laugh or clomp. Each footstep of their heavy boots landed as softly as a cat's paw. They carried the captain inside the shelter. Flora had not heard them say a word, but color had returned to his cheeks. Flora poked her head under her blanket. "Let's go take a look at this place," she said to the fluff of the orange. Sophia didn't stir. Flora brought her head back out and blinked in the sun. The training in the hold had been hard, but Flora was stronger and more confident now. She was ready to learn new lessons, and she could not ignore her curiosity about the Antarctic. Sophia's words sounded muffled. "There's nothing to see." True, the land was white in every direction. Not a plant, not a tree, not any spot of green or brown was visible outside the little camp. Except for a jumble of ice blocks that stuck out of the snow here and there, the terrain was also flat. "I'm going to go see it anyway," Flora eased out from under the warm blanket, careful not to step on Sophia. The wind bit into Flora's ribs as she looked first one way and then another. In the distance, a low ridge of mountains rose out of the white. In the other direction, the white took on the light shade of blue, where the ice met the sea and bobbed on the waves. She shivered as she remembered floating in the lifeboat out there. Flora decided to explore a wide circle around camp. The edge of camp felt even colder than the center, and by the time Flora had traveled only halfway, even her teeth were cold. The stiff air froze the insides of her nostrils. There were no smells. This was a land that kept secrets. Sophia kept complaining noises as Flora nosed back under her blanket, bringing in the sharp polar breeze for a moment. When darkness came, Flora noticed how hungry she was and realized she hadn't seen anyone eating in camp. She snuggled up closer to Sophia for warmth and promised herself that she would not be the first to grumble over something they must all be feeling. The next morning, the men brought out a large square of material and spread it out next to the snow cabin. "Is that some kind of special blanket?" Flora asked Oscar. Oscar took his nose out from under his tail and looked up. "Canvas," he said. "They use it for covering loads or making a shelter." The edges of the canvas were marked in the snow with shovels, and then it was folded up again. Through the day, the men took turns digging out a rectangle a little smaller than the size of the canvas. All the snow they took out was piled around the perimeter. They chopped and shoveled, piled and padded, until the lowered floor was flat and the snow walls were even, except for an opening with snow stairs going down. Finally, they unfolded the canvas, draped it over the walls, pulled it tight, and packed snow on the roof's edges to the canvas so the canvas would stay put. When the shelter was finished, they moved their tools and supplies inside. Flora was curious about everything and took quick breaks from her blanket to poke her nose into the new shelter as often as she could without getting stepped on or noticed by Big Amos. He stayed under the canvas, growling orders to the men about where to stack the supplies that had been salvaged. None of this activity was of any interest to the dogs, who mostly slept or stretched and then slept some more. But all of that changed when the bags filled with frozen fish were carried in. The dogs sat up and sniffed the air. A couple tried to sneak through the doorway, but were chased out. It wasn't long before Amos emerged with his arms full of cans. The men built up the fire again, opened the cans, and put them carefully on the flames. When enough time had passed, they used sticks to lift the hot cans off the fire and sat around eating with their knives. From the smells, Flora could tell they had warmed tomatoes, beans, and chicken soup for their first Antarctic meal. She was disappointed that none of it was shared with the animals, who watched every bite disappear. Even Sophia poked her head out to look, but the feelings changed to joy when Amos brought over a bag of fish. He opened the bag and began chopping the frozen fish into pieces. The dog set up a frenzy of barking and whining, but any that came too close got a curse and a kick, and they soon learned that those that sat quietly were fed first. Flora ate her fish alongside Sophia. It was icy and crunchy and gone in three bites, but it was delicious. While the animals were eating, the men took a bundle of blankets into the canvas-roofed shelter, then disappeared inside the snow cabin next door. Flora followed the dogs into the shelter and watched them claiming sleeping spots. The men had laid the blankets around the perimeter of the shelter. Each dog stood a moment on the spot he had picked and looked around to see if he had a challenger. Then, nose down, each circled three or four times, pawing at the blanket to fluff it up before sinking into a tight ball and bringing tail over muzzle. When all six of the dogs were settled inside, Flora trotted back to where Sophia was, trying to keep warm near the dying fire. "Come see what's happening. We need to choose a sleeping spot." "It won't matter because it's impossible to get warm anywhere in this place," Sophia complained, but she got up. Against the snow, she looked more orange than ever. She hurried across the white ground to the doorway like a cat-shaped sunset. At the entrance, Sophia stopped and let Flora go in first. Flora hoped the dogs had heard about the job she and Sophia had done on the rats and would accept them as friends. She walked cautiously down the few steps. As nervous as Flora felt around the dogs, she could only imagine what Sophia was feeling, but the cat bravely made her way to a blanket in the farthest corner. Then she nosed underneath a corner and disappeared. Flora carefully sat on the blanket Sophia had chosen for them and looked around. Oscar was on the nearest blanket, but except for raising his eyebrows, he didn't move. None of the other dogs seemed to notice the newcomers. Nose down, Flora began to circle her blanket as she had seen the dogs do. "Lie down before you step on me," Sophia hissed. Flora settled down. No one barked. No one made an unfriendly comment. She'd been accepted into the sledding team home, which already smelled like dog, but was surprisingly warm. And that's the end of chapter 23.